Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. On today's program, John Russell tells about an unusual brewer in Tokyo. Then Ashley Thompson tells about a threat to one of Tunisia's important crops. Bryan Lynn has the science report, followed by the lesson of the day. So, let's get started.
A small space in Tokyo houses a container of fermenting sake. The bacteria in the 670-liter container will take more than 2 weeks to turn the rice and water inside into Japan's traditional alcoholic drink. But the bacteria are not only alive, they are listening too, said brewer Yoshimi Terasawa. He suggested the kind of music coming from a loudspeaker below the tank determines how the drink will taste. The microorganisms inside are activated by the vibrations, and the taste changes, said the 63-year-old chief brewer of Tokyo Port Brewing. Music is among the unusual methods Terasawa is using at the only sake brewery in the heart of the capital city. Fit into a narrow building, the small operation employs methods that promise to help the environment. The brewery employs special machinery and processes that use less energy and labor than a traditional brewery in the countryside. Making sake on this kind of smaller scale makes it easier to keep the production environment constant, Terasawa said. He has 45 years of experience in the industry. The company produces about 30 kiloliters of sake each year. That is enough to fill almost 42,720 milliliter bottles. But changing tastes and Japan's aging population have reduced demand. The government says the number of sake breweries has decreased two-thirds from its high point in the 1970s to just over 1,100 now. More than half of sake breweries are not making a profit. Other difficulties that sake breweries face include a shortage of workers as brewers retire, increased fuel costs, and problems with the rice supply. Terasawa said his small brewery offers an example of how to deal with those difficulties. The process starts on the fourth floor, where he and an employee steam the rice for 70 minutes. Then they let gravity move the rice through openings in the floors and ceilings to a mold application room on the third floor. Fermentation, using tap water, takes place on the second level. Finally, the sake is put into bottles at ground level. In the future, small breweries like this will have a great deal of merit, Terasawa added. I'm John Russell.
A small insect is hurting Tunisia's prickly pears, an important source of money for the North African country's economy. Bassem Sanoun, a farmer struggling to deal with the insect problem, used the term insomnia, meaning an inability to sleep, to describe the issue. Our biggest fear, which has caused me insomnia, is the fear of the cochineal insect that threatens our harvest, he said. The insect is known to some as the prickly pear cochineal. Farmers and experts say it has damaged large areas and caused concerns about its economic effects since it was first discovered in the country in 2021. The bug gets the sap from cactus pads, causing yellowing and eventual death of the plants. Agricultural expert Fozi Zayani inspected dying prickly pear trees. He said, "The cochineal insect affects the prickly pear tree. As you can see, the trees are dying, and consequently, we are losing the essence of things, which is the cultivation of prickly pears." Zayani said the insect was first discovered in Mexico. It was present there, and they treated it, and had prevention methods, he added. Then it spread to Morocco in 2015. This insect also came to Tunisia in October 2021, in the city of Madia. Zayani estimates that prickly pears represent about 12% of Tunisia's agricultural land, making it second only to olive trees in agricultural wealth. The pears cover approximately 600,000 hectares and are an important source of money for thousands of people, particularly women who harvest and sell the fruit. Sanun told Reuters, "This is our livelihood. It requires a lot of labor, and it's not just the farmer who benefits from it." The Tunisian government and international organizations are now taking steps to try to help deal with the insect's effects. The Food and Agriculture Organization started a $500,000 emergency project to introduce biological control methods, such as ladybugs, which are hunters of the insect. The Tunisian Ministry of Agriculture is promoting sustainable control measures, including changes in agricultural methods, pruning, and cleaning in production areas. "We must have a sustainable solution for the cochineal insect. This situation should not continue this way," said Naima Mafuti, an official at the Ministry of Agriculture. At his farm, Sanun takes measures to clean and protect his healthy prickly pear trees. "But it will be a difficult job if the crisis continues and keeps drying up prickly pear trees." "It starts at the bottom of the tree," he said. Selma Dridi, who owns prickly pear trees, says the problem is out of her control. She said, "God's will prevails. This is God's judgment." I'm Ashley Thompson.
Researchers say new telescope observations suggest an Earth-like planet outside our solar system may hold a large liquid ocean. The exoplanet is known as LHS-1140b. Astronomers believe it sits about 48 light-years away from Earth. A light year is the distance light travels in a year, about 9.5 trillion kilometers. The research, led by astronomers at the University of Montreal in Canada, shows the possibility the exoplanet might hold the right conditions to support some form of life. A study explaining the findings recently appeared in the Astrophysical Journal Letters. The study is based on observations collected in December 2023 by the James Webb Space Telescope. The American Space Agency, NASA, operates the orbiting observatory. Researchers combined the information from the James Webb with existing data to make new estimates for the exoplanet's mass and size. These suggest that LHS-1140b is a promising super-Earth ice or water world, the University of Montreal said in a statement. Some past studies had suggested the exoplanet might be a gas giant, also known as a mini-Neptune. But the researchers said the new study provides evidence that LHS-1140b is more likely a super-Earth, a rocky planet bigger than Earth. The new research supports a NASA-led study from October 2023 that suggested at least 17 observed exoplanets could hold oceans of liquid water. That study noted that sometimes water from these oceans likely breaks through large pieces of ice to form geysers. Scientists had already identified LHS-1140b as being within its star's habitable zone. Exoplanets found within this zone are believed to have temperatures that would permit water to exist in liquid form. Measurements made by the James Webb data suggest the exoplanet is less dense than expected for a rocky, Earth-like body. The researchers estimated that 10 to 20% of LHS-1140b's mass might be made up of water. The possibility of a large liquid ocean would be found on the side of the planet always facing the star that it orbits. The new data collected by the James Webb showed the exoplanet might also have a nitrogen-rich atmosphere. This differs from earlier research that suggested a possible atmosphere that was mostly hydrogen. Charles Cadou is a doctoral student at the University of Montreal's Trottier Institute for Research on Exoplanets. He was the lead writer of the study. Cadou said in a statement, "Of all currently known temperate exoplanets, LHS-1140b could well be our best bet to one day indirectly confirm liquid water on the surface of an alien world beyond our solar system." He noted that if the study's findings can be confirmed, the data would represent a major milestone in the search for exoplanets that could possibly support life. René Doyon is a project scientist at the University of Montreal. He helped lead the research. He said more observations will be needed to confirm the current study's findings. The current hint of a nitrogen-rich atmosphere begs for confirmation with more data, Doyon said. He estimated that at least one more year of observations will be needed to confirm that LHS-1140b has an atmosphere. The process of confirming whether carbon dioxide is present in the atmosphere and liquid water exists on the surface would likely require several years of observations, Doyon noted. Ryan McDonald is a NASA Sagan Fellow in the University of Michigan's Department of Astronomy who helped examine the James Webb data. He said, "This is the first time we have ever seen a hint of an atmosphere on a habitable zone rocky or ice-rich exoplanet. With further data collection and investigation, McDonald noted there is a good possibility we might just have found evidence of air on this world." I'm Bryan Lynn.
Now, Bryan Lynn joins me to talk more about his science report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Sure, Mario. Glad to be here.
This week, you reported on new research suggesting a large Earth-like planet outside our solar system may contain a liquid ocean. What else did the researchers learn about this exoplanet?
So, yes, this possibility that this exoplanet might hold liquid water is what got the researchers the most excited, for sure. And this is really because they said having water could indicate this planet might have the right conditions to support some form of life as well. But the group's observations also noted, for example, that the exoplanet might have a nitrogen-rich atmosphere. They said this could be important because it would make the planet even more similar to Earth, which also has a nitrogen-heavy atmosphere.
We heard in the report that the astronomers who took part in the study have said they will need to carry out further research to confirm the early findings. What is the process expected to involve?
The researchers did say they are fairly confident about their findings related to water being on the exoplanet, perhaps even a liquid ocean, but they will be looking at additional imaging to confirm that. And another area the team will be centering on is the exoplanet's atmosphere. As we were talking about earlier, they think the atmosphere might be rich in nitrogen. But also they want to examine more telescope data to make some new measurements specifically related to the atmosphere. And by slightly changing their methods, they say they should be able to capture additional information about the atmosphere, for example, whether carbon dioxide or other gases are also present.
Okay. Thanks again for joining me, Bryan. We're looking forward to talking with you again.
You're welcome. Thank you, Mario.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Matteo.
In today's lesson, we'll be teaching 7 expressions in English. You will also hear a bit of music from Anna and her special guest. And we're going to use an audio scrapbook to travel back in time to a previous podcast.
An audio scrapbook?
That's right, and we'll explain that expression in just a few minutes. But first, let's begin with Lesson 23 of Level 2 of the Let's Learn English series.
Anna learns that she'll be interviewing one of her favorite musicians, a woman named Emma G. An interview is a conversation where a reporter or journalist asks questions to a well-known person. Or it can be when one person asks another person a list of questions to find out if they are suitable or a good fit for a job.
Ms. Weaver tells Anna she'll be interviewing Emma G, and Anna gets very excited.
Hello?
Anna, this is Ms. Weaver.
Ms. Weaver?
Tomorrow, you'll be interviewing musician Emma G.
Emma G? I will be talking to Emma G?
Anna? Anna, are you there?
Now, let's hear how the interview begins.
Hello, and welcome to The Music. Today, musician Emma G will be joining us here. She is a wonderful songwriter and an amazing singer. And I love her! Let's give a warm welcome to Emma G! Hi, thank you for coming on the show.
Of course. It's great to be here.
Well, we can't wait to hear you sing. I listen to your music a lot, so I feel like I know you. Is that strange?
Anna, listening to music can be a very personal experience. So no, that's not strange.
Good, because I made something for you. A video scrapbook of our friendship. I took photos of you and added myself. I worked on it all weekend.
Well, that's strange. Is that even legal?
Emma G thinks it's strange that Anna took photos of her and made a scrapbook. The scrapbook has photos of Emma G and Anna together, as if they are close friends.
There's that word again, scrapbook. Let's explain. A scrapbook is a book with empty pages, but on the pages you can put photos or newspaper articles or other things to help you remember special experiences.
A few minutes ago, I said we were going to use an audio scrapbook. That means we'll revisit a previous podcast and listen to an explanation of the future continuous tense. You've already heard the future continuous several times today. Here are some examples.
In today's lesson, we'll be teaching 7 expressions in English.
Ms. Weaver tells Anna she'll be interviewing Emma G.
Hello, and welcome to The Music. Today, musician Emma G will be joining us here.
And here is our explanation from a previous podcast, based on Lesson 45 of Level 1 of the series. She will have to wait, but our listeners can notice right now a special way we can talk about the future in English. It's called the future continuous tense. Listen again.
Marcia, we just left D.C. We'll be eating lunch in about 2 hours.
Instead of saying we're going to eat in 2 hours, Anna says,
we'll be eating lunch in about 2 hours.
That's because it takes some time to eat. For actions in the future that take some time to do, we can use the modal will plus the verb be plus the main verb with ing. For example, listen to this exchange.
What will you be doing tomorrow afternoon?
I'll be working from noon until 6 p.m.
We often use the future continuous when we specify, or say, the amount of time we expect the activity to take. If we don't know or care about the length of time, then we can just use the expression going to, like in this exchange.
Do you have any plans for the weekend?
I'm going to try to clean my room and maybe go to a movie.
Okay, we're back. It's handy to have a scrapbook, isn't it?
It is. Handy describes something that is useful or helpful that makes a job easier.
Now, let's get back to Anna's interview with Emma G. You can listen for the future continuous tense.
Now, Emma, let's talk about your schedule. Tell me, tell us, exactly where you will be and when. Exactly.
Sure. Well, in early June, I'll be performing at several venues across Austin, Texas.
That's my vacation week. I can meet you there. We can tour the city. We can have lunch.
Yeah, maybe. Then in mid-July, I'm going to be teaching at a music camp in Chicago.
I will be visiting my sister then. She only lives 6 hours from Chicago. I could drive over. We could hang out.
Yeah, maybe. You know, maybe now's a good time for some music.
That's a great idea. Now, let's hear a song from Emma G.
Yay! I wrote this song a couple of years ago. It's called Wary.
It seems like Anna might be obsessed with Emma G, because Anna wants to visit her in two cities.
If you are obsessed with something or someone, it means you think about them all the time, or almost too much. The noun form of this word is obsession.
And I think Emma G is becoming wary of Anna. Maybe that's why she chose to sing her song called Wary.
Maybe so. Wary is an adjective that means you are being very careful because of something that could cause problems or be dangerous. Wary is spelled W-A-R-Y.
For example, you should be wary of a hairy bear.
And you should be very wary of an angry bear.
I think you should be wary of bears in general.
I do too. Notice that we use the preposition of after the adjective wary.
Now, let's look at two more expressions we heard. The word venue and the phrasal verb hang out. Listen again.
Well, in early June, I'll be performing at several venues across Austin, Texas.
A venue is a place for an organized gathering of people, such as a concert, sporting event, or special meeting such as a convention. Most venues are indoors, but some are outdoors, such as a farmer's market or a stadium.
And the phrasal verb hang out is just an informal way of saying spend time together. It's very common in American English. But remember, it's informal, so we usually use that expression with friends and family.
Yeah, like Andrew, maybe we can hang out next weekend.
That's right, maybe we can.
So to review, today we looked at the expressions interview, handy, scrapbook, wary of, venue, obsessed by, obsession, and hang out.
Before we go, here's the end of Lesson 23 of Level 2. Anna gets to sing with Emma G. They sing a bit of a song that came out in the year 1983 by the group named The Police. The song is named Every Breath You Take. And you can hear the future continuous tense in that song.
The songwriter, named Sting, says it may sound romantic at the beginning, but it's really about an obsession. He wrote it after the breakup of his first marriage. Here's Anna and Emma singing the song.
Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you. I'll be watching you.
And we hope you'll be watching Lesson 23 of Level 2, and all of the Let's Learn English series. And we'll be doing another lesson of the day soon.
Remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.